Welcome to another inspiring message with Pastor Deborah Bell from Deo Gloria, South Africa, as she brings you a word from God.
Turn around to someone and say, fullness is coming your way.
Fullness is coming your way.
Amen, amen. Praise God. Now give someone a high five and say, it's here.
It's here.
Oh no, I saw two people. Give someone a high five and say, it's here.
It's here.
Come on. It's here.
It's here.
Come on, come on, come on. How many of you believe that this morning? See, we are called to be inheritors of the fullness of Christ. The word speaks all over, not just about someday when we're playing the harp on that cloud, which is not what we're going to be doing in heaven. Amen. We're going to be worshiping. Hallelujah. Maybe eating a bit of fruit in between and sitting along the river that runs through heaven. Amen.
Amen.
Walking along the golden streets as is described. But how many know that God is calling us to bring heaven to earth? Amen. Never were we supposed to take earth to heaven. We're supposed to be, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in
heaven.
That means the power, the glory, the manifest presence of Christ is the only way that you and I can inherit the fullness. We cannot inherit the fullness of life any other way because we were created with a void that only Jesus Christ can fill. And once we've accepted Christ as our Lord and Savior, as I said last week, and we move along that journey into a place of maturity, the body of Christ is all important in that journey. Amen?
Yes.
But we can only reach fullness of life if we have fullness in Christ. Amen?
Yes.
Tell your neighbor, you can only reach fullness of life,
if you have fullness in Christ.
Oh, that's a good one. I thought that's good. Hallelujah.
Yes.
That's a tweeter. That's a tweeter for Twitter. Got to be careful how you say that. Amen.
Amen.
So what do I mean by fullness in Christ? Well, I've just explained it in a paraphrased way, but let me tell you, spiritual fullness is when we live and write this down in the totality and fullness of God's divine power, love, presence, and attributes given to human beings as gifts by the Holy Spirit to bring the kingdom of God to the whole earth. See, we're not just a local church. We're a kingdom church. We have a kingdom mindset. There's a much greater purpose than this little local church sitting in Durban and this little spot on the map. The Lord is connecting and joining the church worldwide for a greater purpose of what God is about to unleash. And the magnitude of God's glory, that is the manifest presence. That's what the glory is. It's the manifest presence of God on the earth. Now, where the manifest presence of God is, the manifest power of God usually resides. Remember what I taught you? The glory is the presence of God. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
But the anointing is the power of God. Amen?
Amen?
So it's very important to understand. And I said those two must go together. There are all sorts of people wandering around and they've forgotten about the presence and they work just the anointing, the power of God without the presence of God. That's dangerous. Hallelujah. That's why I say you never ever just look at the gifts. You always look at the fruit in people's lives. Hallelujah. That's another story for another time. You know that I always teach that. So the Greek word for fullness is this word, the state of being filled. It's the Greek word pleroma. And it means to be filled so as to leave no part vacant. Do you remember that? So Christ's idea for human beings was never that we are left in a state of brokenness. It's never that we were left in a state of depression. It's never that we are left in a state of loneliness. It's never that we are left blah, 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 blah. But that we are able to live in the full measure of all these things I've just described are the fullness of Christ. Amen. Here and now. Not in the near future. Here and now. That journey for some of you will start today. That journey for others has started already. But you were never ever called to live with any kind of a void in you the moment you came to Christ. The moment you said, Jesus, I receive you as my Lord and Savior, the one who I know has redeemed me, who died for me, who rose again on the third day. And now, today, I don't live just at the foot of the cross, but I live in the power of the resurrection. Amen? We know that. We have resurrection life. The Bible says the same power that raised Jesus from the dead is available to every believer. And it's not for us to go radical and go red on everyone. It's so that we can be inheritors of the glory, that we can be overcomers through the blood of the Lamb. You can never be an overcomer in your situation or your problems or the struggles that you have when you don't believe in the highest source, which, by the way, is not just in the plants and in the trees and in the wind and in the breeze. The highest source is a living being whose name is Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And God is separate from God's creation. Even though God is separate, God is not distant, God is involved in God's creation. Amen. Hallelujah. So it's very important. That's why I mentioned the hairs on the head. Because God has a vested interest in every one of us to live in the fullness. The problem is we stop short of that because we don't ever think we can, because we're still going with the capacity of our own minds and not taking what the Word has said is the truth. Not living by the word, living by the power of our own capacity. You can never live in the fullness of Christ that way. So it means the state of being filled so as to leave no part vacant. That means abundance. Tell your neighbor, abundance. Abundance. Tell someone else on the other side, abundance. Abundance. Tell somebody behind you, abundance. Abundance. Tell someone in front of you, abundance. Abundance. Okay, whoever's there. Amen. Hallelujah. We declare it. We speak it with our mouths. So how do we come into this fullness? We bow down, we yield, we surrender to be all of what we can be and be more like Christ. Amen. We do it no matter what the cost. And that requires obedience, which will mean often waiting on the timing of God. Part of your growth in your life of faith is waiting on God and not making a move because of fear. That is the, if you had to ask me as a pastor in my 2.5 decades or 2 and a bit decades, what is the most difficult thing that I have to deal with when it comes to seeing people fall off the bus? And it's that. So I can tell you something for free right now, that fear is the most dangerous thing in a human being's life when it's not there for the right reasons. Remember, we know there's an inherent part of us that's fearful to stop us going into danger, but when our perceptions, if I may use that word, are distorted and are wrong and are distorted because of past hurts and all of those things that I've been speaking to you about over several weeks and months, and as part of the mandate of this church to help people heal from their brokenness, hallelujah. Because so many people get healed in their physical side and all of this and all of that, and they forget about their emotions and their brokenness. Or so many people think that they've been healed from their brokenness, and then they come into this church and they realize they haven't. Why? Because we're a kingdom church. Because we believe that the word of God is there to transform us. It's to take us higher. It's to take us from glory to glory. And to do that, we've got to get rid of all the little gremlins that are taking up space in our heads and in our spirit, in our souls. Hallelujah. And so the Lord wants a pure body, not a perfect body, but it requires obedience. It requires us waiting on the timing of God. And to do that, we have to have faith. So often we look around and we say, you know what, God, I just don't see you coming through for me. I cannot see how that is going to be possible. Remember, when we talk about waiting on the Lord, it's not waiting on the Lord and still doing my own thing. It's waiting on the Lord by being positioned exactly where God has called me. That's why obedience comes with faith. Obedience has to go hand in hand with faith. Because you can't walk a faith walk and see the manifestation of all that God has for you if you're not walking in obedience. Because if you're not walking in the will of God, how are you going to be an inheritor of the blessing? How are you going to be an inheritor of that word of prophecy? How are you going to be an inheritor of what God has on of the fullness? Is anybody in this house this morning? Is there anybody in this house this morning?
Amen.
Please give me an amen. Help me.
Amen.
Help me, Jesus. Do you know what I'm saying? And we have all sorts of fears for many different reasons. But that's why we want a healthy body of Christ, a healthy church. Because the purpose of the church is to help us move from just knowing Christ, just giving our lives to Christ, to moving into a place of healing and then into a place of wholeness. And the wholeness is part of the fullness. Are you with me? So the church is a very important part of us moving into our fullness. You know, so many people... There's some certain signs when people are falling off the bus. And one of them is that they start to wane from coming to church. There's just signs. Most pastors will know this. There are certain signs. There's like, I don't know, what are there? There's five stages of falling away and there's all sorts of things. But that's doom and gloom. I don't want to talk to you about it. I just want you to know that so often we can see these signs. And at first the only thing we can do is pray, because you can't go and confront someone about where they are if they aren't ready to hear. Amen? And so what happens is people begin to wane. And before long, they're not in the church, so they're not getting the word. They're not getting this word spoken over their lives. So they lose hope. They lose faith. Because this word is active and alive and sharper than any double-edged sword. It brings life into our being, into our spirit. And so what happens is people begin to fall. And so they stop coming to church. And so soon enough, they'll be saying, I don't really need to go to church to serve the Lord. And it's true. But it's like that garage and the car story, remember? It's true. You don't have to be. But you can never live in the fullness of who you're called to be if you are not living in the church family. Because it's in the church family where you learn how to be guided into the truth of the word. How you learn all the possibilities that are open to you in the supernatural. How your faith is honed. How your faith is grown. How you move into the fullness is in the body of Christ, which is God's idea. Amen. And Jesus is the one that said, I will build my church on this rock. Jesus spoke about it and he said, you know who he said that about? He said that about Peter. Come on. Was Peter perfect? No. He's talking about building his church on imperfect people. He's talking about building his church on the one that denied him three times. On the one that said, Lord, Lord, you can't wash my feet. Come wash my feet, Lord. And he said, as long as I never wash your feet, you can never be a part of me. Then he says to him later on, when he's risen and he's in his glorified state, he says, Jim Peter, do you love me? Three times. The church, Jesus himself said, on this rock, Peter, I will build my church. And the gates, Matthew 16, and the gates of hell will not prevail against her. Come on. So do you think that when you're standing there as a lone ranger, without any covering of the church, without any teaching and guidance from this word, or from those that are trained in this word, that you can be honest with yourself about where you are in your growth, where you are in the Word of God. No, of course not. And you never reach fullness because there's no protection of the body. There's no guidance. There's no increase in faith. All you do is end up whittling down to become one of the statistics of a person that loves the Lord, that believes in God, but eventually is just stagnating. So you still can tell people, I love God. And when you hear somebody talking about the Lord, you're going to get excited because you never hear it anywhere else. Because you're not in the body. The body was designed so that we could be protected. It says the gates of hell will not prevail against her. And so if we are under the protection of the body, we're able to grow into the fullness and the wholeness of who we call to be. But not just anybody. Not just anybody. When I say the body, for those that don't know, I'm talking about the church. The church is referred to as the body of Christ. The body of Christ in the Word of God. Amen? And so here we have the body of Christ. And Jesus himself says, my church will be built on this kind of a person. This imperfect man. This man who betrayed me. This man who said he didn't even know me. On those types of people, I will build my church. Because I have come to heal the brokenhearted. I have come to set the captives free. I have come to make whole those that are broken. That's what Jesus said. Isaiah 61 is a prophetic passage about what Jesus came to do. And if that's what Jesus came to do, the Bible says we are supposed to do as Jesus did. And that's what we are called to do as the church. The church was never meant to be a place that was powerless. It was never meant to be a place of religiosity. It was meant to be a place of power where people could be saved, healed, and made whole and enter into the fullness of their calling and the fullness of who they called to be in their families, living wholesome lives, not perfect, on this rock. On this type of person, I will build my church. That's the problem. There are too many pastors in too many churches that are acting like they are perfect, that are acting like there's nothing wrong with their lives. And that is the most dangerous thing you can do to your congregation, because you make them believe that that's what they have to be like, when you know that they're not actually like that. We as pastors know. Many, many pastors. And that's why we call for transparency in this church, because it's healthy, a healthy transparency. We don't want to know the color of your underwear. Hallelujah. Unless you really feel it's important to share. On this rock, on that rock, on that rock, on that rock, on that rock, I will build, on this rock, I'll build my church. Amen. The least of them. Jesus kept on showing people time and time again that it's the least of them that I will raise up. Yes. Why are we always looking for the grandeur and the splendor and the big things? Jesus never ever went where there was a crowd. The crowds always came to him. Yeah. He never went and said, oh, well, you know what? I think that crowd's big enough, so I'll go and preach over there. Book me over there, Peter. Book me over there. But God has called the church to be the place, which is called the family of God, so that we can grow, that we can learn, that we can be made whole, that we can flourish, because we will learn the way that we should go through the Word of God that we sit under, that we are taught. We have pastors in place to help us as families and as human beings to journey every single day in the way we're living and the right living, amen. Not perfect living, not, oh, well, you know what, if I go to church and I start really getting involved, I'm quite worried about that. Besides my commitment issues, what will I have to give up? What will I have to give up? You'd be surprised how many of us have commitment issues. What will I have to give up? Don't worry about that stuff. That's just the enemy on your shoulder. Just draw in. God's not interested in the things you think are important. God's interested in the things that God knows you need healing in, that you need. And you know what? You'll never have to do more than you're ready to do. Hallelujah. That's a healthy church. So on this rock, on that type of person, firstly, notice that the person that Christ chose was an apostle. Hallelujah. He chose an apostle because that person will carry an anointing, the breaker anointing. And the churches of today need to have a breaker anointing. There needs to be under a covering of a breaker anointing or something so that they can get breakthrough and they can be a kingdom church. We're reaching our towns, our cities, and nations.
Hallelujah.
And the churches are coming together as one for what God is about to do.
Oh, yeah.
Hallelujah. But we've got to stay the course. We've got to be planted in the body of Christ.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Yeah. Somebody give me a hallelujah. Let me give you some scripture to back up why the church is important. It's mentioned in so many areas of the Bible. I can't give them all to you now, but you can go and study that for yourself. But in Hebrews 10, 25, and I'm going to go back to Acts 2 because I'm going to tell you why in a minute. Because this morning we're talking about the importance of the church in reaching our fullness. Amen.
Yeah.
Hebrews 10, 20 to 25. Read it with me. If you got it, say amen. If you got it. When you got it, say amen. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy, read it with me, the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, open for us through the curtain that is his body. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, which is Christ, let us draw near to God with sincere hearts in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water. Keep going. Read it with me. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us, here's the verse, underline these two in your Bible, and let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. And let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing. But let us encourage one another. And all the more as you see the day approaching. That scripture is very clear as to why we need to be consistently coming to church. Because we encourage one another at church. How many know the moment you start stopping coming to church, eventually you don't want to come anymore? Write this down.
Amen.
The flesh is weak, but the spirit is willing. Amen?
Amen.
And we've got to get to a place in our spiritual maturity where there's nothing that will stand in the way of our time with the Lord on a Sunday. No visitors that suddenly pop in on a Sunday morning. They're going to learn. Listen, that's my time at church. That's when I go. I'm in the house of the Lord. Listen, guys, you can't visit me on a Sunday. If you visit me on a Sunday, you're going to have to come with me to church.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Somebody, they won't come. They won't come. They'll soon stop visiting you on a Sunday morning. Amen. Hallelujah. It's okay. You tell them come, and then you bring them to church. Amen. So the thing is, it's so important because what happens is you actually, because the flesh is always going to be in conflict with your spirit. So it's very easy. We can get lazy about church. We can go, blah. But once we're there, we realize, sure, I'm so glad I came. So let your spirit rule and take dominion over your flesh. And that is the difference. That's when the switch of maturity happens. Amen. So let's just get some things in our spirit. Why do we need the fullness of Christ? Just write these down quickly. Just some four things here. To bring hope and light into the world and live as God intended us. To bring hope and light into the world, to live as God intended us. Secondly, because it's mandated in Matthew 28:18. We're called to it. We're called to move into the fullness. We're called to bring that fullness into the earth. Thirdly, for the kingdom, because we cannot live a supernatural life without the power, the presence, and the gifts of Jesus operating in us through faith. We cannot live a supernatural life without the power and presence, and I've just said that earlier. So it's to bring about the kingdom, what I said. The fourth thing, lead people and nations into a kingdom understanding through a demonstration of Christ's power. To lead kingdoms and nations. Does that sound like a weak church to you? Does that sound like some place that should be poor and poverty stricken and look so humble, because the poorer they are, the more poverty stricken they are, the more humble they are? Nonsense. The more money we have in this church, the more we can give away. There are so many dreams and desires we have for abused women and children. For there are so many things that we need to build and do for the kingdom that others have not done. How do you think we're going to do it? Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
But we're going to, because we have God on our side.
Amen.
And we have stood through many storms, and we will stand through many other storms.
Amen.
Because
yeah.
God is on our side, and God has never failed us.
But
how do we do it? Could I stand alone and do it for these 23 years? Could I stand on my own just serving God and keep on keeping on? Absolutely not. I would have been finished. It's because of the body of Christ.
Hallelujah.
It's because of the body of Christ. So what should this church look like? Because you have to know what it's going to look like if it plays such an important role in the fullness. Amen?
Amen.
So we have to understand what it's supposed to look like. And if you turn with me quickly to the book of Acts, I've already said some of it. I've told you about Matthew 16. I've told you about Peter. Jesus said, on this rock, on this type of person, I will build my church. That's the first way that we have to understand. That's what the church is going to look like. There's so many people that have been hurt in the name of Christianity. There's so many people that have been hurt in the name of the church. Let me just get this straight. There are also people that say they've been hurt by the church, but it's never the church. It's because they have to blame someone. So let's just know there's a balance. Amen?
Yeah.
The other thing is, there are many people, and especially in our community, that have been so hurt by the church, and many of you will know this if you've journeyed with me, that they can't even think about coming to a church. Amen? They might love God, but they can't reconcile their sexual orientation with their faith. Hallelujah. That is just a fact. That's one of the things. And we have to be building a church where all people are welcome, because that's always been the mandate.
Yes.
Never ever has God excluded anybody. Men and women have used the word of God to try and bring discrimination against people. The same way that it was done with people of color years ago, where we used slavery as an example. And we said, hey, look, people, it's in the Bible. That's not the church that Christ said, I'm going to build. Christ said, hey, you know what? It's on people. You see this Deborah Bell chick? She's the kind of person I'm going to build my church on. Because she's imperfect, but she's got staying power.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
And she'll put out fires and she'll start new ones.
Hallelujah.
Why? Not because of anything I can do. Nothing I can do. But because I understand the magnitude of the power of a living God. I understand the magnitude of the power of what the church is supposed to be. Hallelujah. It's a living, breathing organism. It's the family of God. It's not just this institution. Historical institution. It's got to be a place that is thriving and flourishing. Why should the Babylonian system, the kingdom of the evil one, the world system, have all the power and all the money? We've got to start conquering some of those mountains, people of God.
Yes,
and that's exactly what the church, with a capital C, globally is doing.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Listen, the church is meant to be a place of power. Jesus wouldn't say, and the gates of hell will not prevail against her.
Amen.
There is a war in the spirit realm, whether we see it or not. But the Bible says we are victors.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Come on, there's something good about that.
Yes.
Acts chapter 2, just very quickly, turn with me. Are you all still alive?
Yes.
Are you all still here?
Yes.
How many want fullness?
Yes.
How many want fullness?
Yes.
Hallelujah. So here's what the church is supposed to look like, because we need to know what it's supposed to look like. The one, it's going to look like imperfect people. Hallelujah. We know that story. Acts chapter 2, verse 42. How many of you were at home group? You would have learned this in home group study this week. Read it with me. Acts chapter 2, verse 42. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship and to the breaking of bread and to prayer. It says, verse 43, keep going. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and miraculous signs that were being done by the apostles. Keep going. All the believers, tell your neighbor, all. All the believers were together and had everything in common. Selling their possessions and goods, they gave to anyone as they had need. Keep going. Every day, say every day. They continued to meet together. Read with me in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and they ate together with glad and sincere hearts. And it goes on in verse 47 to say, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those that were being saved. Friends, that is just a little glimpse of what the church is supposed to look like. We are supposed to be devoted to the teachings of God, of Christ, which come through those that oversee us. It says that they constantly prayed together. Don't go there with me. This is just Acts chapter 1 and verse 14. It says they all joined together constantly in prayer. Constantly. Why? Why? What happened? I'll tell you what happened. Because you know what you read in the book of Acts. That's when the Holy Spirit, the Paraclete, the Advocate, the Comforter, the Helper, the one who brings power into our lives and gives us discernment. And the Bible says who teaches us the truth about who Christ is. The deep things of God. The Paraclete came upon the people. The 120, no more than we're sitting in a room like this, the upper room. And suddenly a wind came through the place and tongues of fire came and sat on there. Does this sound like a story you could comprehend with your mind? Does anything about creation sound like it's anything you can comprehend? Then why is it that the church is so dead today? Why is it that we're sitting? We've got to have, there's got to be more people. And there is more. There's got to be more to life. There's fullness of life. There's much more. We don't have to suffer with depression. We've got to get to the roots of those things and let God bring healing and restoration to us so that we can be all that we're called to be and live in the fullness of the promise. That comes in the church. Hallelujah. Because there's power in the church. And so we see that they met together constantly. They joined together. I mean, Peter even had to address the crowd in Acts chapter 2 and say to them, listen, people, all the onlookers in the upper room, and say to them, listen, guys, can I just tell you something? Just know these people aren't drunk. It's only 9 o'clock in the morning. Although there might be some, but I'm just saying. Not in this book. He said, they're not drunk as you suppose, just filled with the Holy Ghost. This is that which the prophet Joel spoke about. And what is that? It's the very prophetic word that came out of the Old Testament. This Bible doesn't contradict itself. It's living and active. Joel spoke about this and said that in the last days, I will pour out my spirit on how many? Just this section over here. No, just the section over here. No, just that church over there. No. On all people. And your sons and daughters will prophesy. This is that. Friends, we are living in a this is that time right now. Hallelujah. This is that which the prophet Joel spoke about. This is that which the churches, I love it when we get confirmation because we're still isolated as a church in many respects. We have to rely on reading up and being read up on prophets that we know are worldwide prophets that have walked the walk and talked the talk and been proved as people of integrity. And it is so incredible that we see what goes on in this church and how the Lord brings confirmation of those words. Because we always seek confirmation. Amen? Yeah. We don't want to be renegades moving off into false doctrine. Amen? Amen? This word is what we hold true to. So here we see, if you want to start reading the Word of God, I say, you know, a lot of people say read the book of Mark, others say John. I say that's good, but if you want to keep reading, read the book of Acts. Because let me tell you, what the church is supposed to look like, my friends, is what you read in the book of Acts. That is the early church. The book of Acts talks about the early church, that people were healed in that one whose name was Peter, in his shadow. In his shadow, people were healed. People healed in someone's shadow? Okay, but that was for then, Apostle, not now. Not now. I mean, come on. Okay, well then why is God still healing today? The Lord wants us to be a church that is like the Book of Acts church, on fire for Jesus, so excited and ignited with the power of the Spirit in our lives that if we could, we would meet every day. Do you know how revivals start in churches and in cities? By the hunger of the people. What is the thermometer for revival? It's hunger. God's not going to pour in what we're not hungry for. You all know that. So we need to have a hunger in our hearts for more. And God will pour out God's Spirit. God will move in our hearts and in our lives. Amen? Because in revivals, you see them meet every day. You see that church's doors are open almost 24/7. Those pastors have to plan things so carefully because they don't always know when a revival is going to hit their church. And all of a sudden, a revival hits, like happened in Florida. In the 90s, that church, in Brownsville, that went on for, what was it? Was it 2 years or something? Can you imagine the kind of exhaustion standing up there every single night, even if you have guest preachers, having the doors of your church open, having the staff work every night? That's not easy going. I mean, there's a lot of infrastructure to a service every Sunday. And I can tell you right now that when God moves quickly. And we know for a fact that God is about to move on this earth, is already starting to move. There are fires being started in all the earth, friends. And I am telling you, I am not going to get left behind. I don't want to miss what God is doing in the earth right now. I want to be part of that fullness. I don't want to, when you've had a touch from Jesus, you don't want to move. How many of you say, I want some fire this morning? I want to do an activation of fire over your lives this morning. Because the Bible in Acts speaks about a church on fire. It speaks about the tongues of fire which represent Holy Spirit and the power of a living God to touch people with a burning desire. You know what? Some people in the churches today look drunk. They look like they're falling all over the place. But it's not with the spirits that cause you to lose brain cells and all of those things. Amen? Yeah. And I'm not condemning drinking, so don't get all religious on me. Amen? Yeah. Listen, there's a difference. If you're not supposed to drink, if you have a problem with alcohol, you shouldn't drink. Mm. Listen to me. Yeah. Not even one, because you won't stop. Yeah. Yeah. Amen? Yeah. But I am telling you what I know. And listen, I've studied this stuff. Not just the Bible. Amen? Amen? Yeah. And I can tell you firsthand, I know what I'm saying. But no one's saying don't have a drink, but you're not supposed to get drunk. The word is absolutely clear. The question is whether you know you're drunk or not. Or acknowledge whether you are. The best way, don't drink at all. That's my philosophy in that sense. Amen? Or socially or on occasion. But listen, once you start getting filled with the Holy Spirit, friends, can I tell you what? There's no condemnation for those in Christ. We don't have that issue in this church, all right? I'm not saying we don't have a drinking issue. I'm saying we don't have that issue of condemning people. God didn't come to condemn us. What I'm saying to you is that when you're filled with the Holy Spirit, when the Spirit of God comes upon your life and you experience the fullness of the Spirit in your life, friends, you don't want the other stuff. You want more of the thing that doesn't give you a headache. You want more of that euphoria that comes with a definite touch of the Holy Spirit over your life. If you're saying this morning, you know what, Lord, I need to be touched. I need a touch. I need that fire of your Spirit in my spirit. I want to be on fire. I want to be like that Book of Acts church. Amen. Because I want to be an inheritor of the fullness. And if that's you this morning, and I haven't even touched on this, so get ready for next week's teaching, because there are many things that God wants to tell us about why the church is important to receiving our fullness. Amen. It's ordained by God. It's a place of covenant, just like a marriage. That's why it's called the Bride of Christ, because Jesus is the bridegroom, just like a marriage. Marriage was instituted by God for that reason, because Jesus is the bridegroom, and we are the Bride of Christ as the church. That means that we're entering into a covenant relationship by the blood of Jesus. That's how. So that's what I'm going to speak about next week. It's going to be exciting. But for now, stand with me, people. Stand with me. I haven't even touched on this. Oh, my Lord. It says that the apostles perform many signs and wonders among the people. Many signs. Even to the point where the church of the day, the Sanhedrin of the day, were trying to persecute the apostles, were trying to break the apostles down. And do you know what happened? Do you know what happened? One of the guys in the Sanhedrin stood up. And you know what he said? He said, listen. He said, if this is really from God, nothing's going to be able to stop them. But if it's not from God, you'll stop them. So if it's from God, nothing can stop them. He even recognized that. Friends, when Christ is in you and you allow the Spirit of God to be activated and ignited in you, nothing can stop you. Nothing can stop you reaching the fullness of Christ. Nothing can stop you moving into the fullness of your destiny. Nothing can stop you reaching the heights of every dream and vision that you've had for your life. But you just turn around and you say, devil, get behind me. I will draw close to the Lord. And as I draw close, the Lord draws close, and I can resist the devil and he will flee. Amen. So right now as I speak, come running up to the front. Come to this altar. Fire of God. Shokoba Shata. Ho! Fire of God. Shakaba Shata. Oh, oh. Fire, fire.
We hope you have been blessed by this message. Join Pastor Deborah next week for another exciting word.
Take your hands together. How shit of a cut! Rubble shondo! Ha! Shikaba! Shakaba! Shut up like a fire.